Okay, I think we're good to go. So let's get started. This event is brought to you by the Rethinking Economics India Network and the Project Statecraft. Good afternoon, everyone. The Rethinking Economics India Network is a national network of the global Rethinking Economics movement. We also operate as a nationwide ecosystem of stakeholders in the space of pluralist and heterodox economics, and are looking to interface with all aspects of agents and partners such as individuals, academia, civil society, and other organizations in order to encourage teaching, learning, and discussions and any further deliberations for scaling collaborative efforts towards rethinking and remaking economics towards more inclusivity and pluralist senses. Our partner for this event is the Project Statecraft. It is a nonpartisan youth-led policy think tank and a youth organization working in the fields of policy research, education, and youth engagement to produce truthful and equitable initiatives and research. Our research team strives to produce academic publications in the form of papers, reports, editorials, and stress on discussions which stir debate and demand policy action in the areas of global affairs, public policy, and governance. Our events in the form of workshops, simulations, and seminars, along with the publications, edify the masses about government policies and instances that shape our surroundings. Together, we are very happy to welcome you to our event titled the E-Colloquium on Income Inequality and Welfare, an Academic and Policy Dialogue. Welcome, everybody. This event is specifically centered around approaching income inequalities and welfare policies from economic, historical, social, political, and philosophical lenses. With this event, we also aim to understand how mainstream economics has produced inefficiencies in the current welfare schemes and has failed to address inequalities, and how pluralism can help bridge the gaps. This is a two-day event spread out over today and tomorrow. Besides this specific session, we also have a welfare policy workshop and followed by another keynote address and a Socratic dialogue, which will be held tomorrow. For the current session, we're going to take the discussion further by deliberating the very pertinent need for inclusivity in the designing and drafting of welfare policies in India. This session would draw an overview of the current welfare system while questioning the policies that have been put out by successive governments over the years. This topic takes on added importance given the current context of the pandemic and its ensuing impacts on the marginalized and ostracized sections of society. For the deliverance of the same, we have with us an eminent practitioner and academic in the policy field, and personally my role model as well, Yamini Aiyar. She is the president and chief executive of the Center for Policy Research. In 2008, she founded the Accountability Initiative at CPR, which has produced significant research in the areas of governance, state capacity, and social policy. Her own research on social accountability, elementary education, decentralization, and administrative reforms has received both academic and popular wide stream recognition. She is also a TED Fellow and a founding member of the International Experts Panel of the Open Government Partnership. She has also been a member of the World Economic Forum and has worked extensively with the World Bank on the water and sanitation program and development and strengthening of the Panchayati Raj systems in India. Before we move on further to the address, I promise I won't take any more of your time, just a few housekeeping questions regarding the Q&A sessions. For all those who do wish to pose questions to Yamini, please do so in the Q&A tab. And you're also free to introduce yourselves in the chat window too. Without any further ado, Yamini, off to you. And thank you so much for doing this again.
Thank you. Thank you so much for inviting me, Yash. The importance of rethinking economics couldn't be more significant in this particular point and particular moment in global history, I think, but also specifically Indian history. And it's an absolute privilege for me to have the opportunity to come and speak to you. So thank you very, very much for inviting me. It's confess that I'm not a trained economist. My discipline, to the extent that you can call it a discipline, is development studies. In some funny way, that also frees you up to think about the question of economics in a much, much more cross-disciplinary and democratic way, which to me is a critical challenge that all economists, actually all disciplines, need to confront when we talk about the importance of rethinking. Because one can only rethink when the canvas is somewhat blank, in that one is freed from the dogmas of the past of many of our disciplines. And I think what we've seen across the globe in these last 8 months is a reminder that past, in fact, I think our democracies were moving in a particular direction that was beginning to express the urgency of questioning past dogmas. And these last 8 months have really brought all the warts of the ways in which our economies had organized themselves, in ways that are so tactile, sharp, and real, as we've all experienced these, some form of this in our own personal lives in these last 8 months, in ways that really, I think, push the urgency of this question. So I was absolutely delighted that there is an India chapter of Rethinking Economics, even more delighted that it is full of all of you, young minds not caught in disciplinary dogmas and particular ways of viewing the world. But most importantly, that I think what you're trying to do in how you've articulated this is to really push a cross-disciplinary dialogue that would enable us to think differently about the challenges that we confront. I'm going to try and speak very little, because I feel that the big challenge with Zoom is that we don't get to see each other, and so it becomes one lecture after another. In order to sort of try and make this more interactive, ordinarily perhaps we would be together face to face in a room that would allow for this exchange. What I'm going to try and do is to present you three propositions that I think need to be considered as we broadly think about rethinking economics, particularly in the context of the questions that Yash had posed to me, thinking about growth versus inequality, thinking about the architecture, structure, role of the welfare state, and the question of pluralism, which I'm taking in this particular context to be much more in terms of deliberation across pillars of society, and looking at how markets, government, and civil society interface with one another to create the kind of outcomes that we seek as a society. So let me first start with the first issue that I want to just present to you as something that I think we need to, a question that I believe we need to be asking, and a proposition that I think to me sort of defines one of the key challenges of the Indian economy, and what the question versus inequality needs to be so front and centered in our debates. And the proposition is this. Actually, this morning, I came across a very wonderful quotation in an opinion piece I was reading in the Times of India on labor reforms, which opens with lines from a textile worker in Surat that says, "I have no problem with the industry. I have no problem with industrial policy, with industrial growth. What I am asking about is in what can in this industry and in this economy." Underlying for me is this question of equal participation. And when you look at this question of equal participation, the growth versus inequality debate starts becoming much more relevant to my framing, which is, it's not a binary of one versus the other. It is a question of how do you ensure one that is genuinely effectively participatory, that enables all to participate in the process of growth. And I think if I have traditional debates on growth versus inequality, growth versus capabilities, in fact, those debates weren't arguing in binaries. They were arguing about what your starting point is and what kind of growth one needs to be looking for. And unfortunately, over time, one gets caught in different dogmas, and we get caught in conversations that sort of create these trade-offs. Economists always like to think of the world in terms of trade-offs. So the trade-offs become, well, why? Whereas actually you should be asking, how do I, once I start asking this, that person, question that we need to ask, enables a growth that is participatory, in which all with citizens can be effective and easy. When you start asking the question from that perspective and look back at the history of India's economic growth, you recognize.
Yamini, can you hear me?
Apologies, something, am I back?
Yes, I was just mentioning to you that your voice was breaking and your video was breaking as well.
Okay, yeah. Oh, sorry. Give me 1 second. I'm gonna try another.
Okay, sure, yes.
Hi, can you see me?
Yes, I think this is
my. Hi, can you see me now?
Your video has frozen, but your voice is audible.
My video. Okay, so shall I just, one moment, let me try, I'll try a mobile hotspot then, because it is saying to me that my video is unstable. Just give me a moment, sorry about this.
No, it's no problem.
First, turn off this. My mobile hotspot is on. Yeah, is this better?
So your video has frozen, but your voice is coming through. Okay, this is slightly better, yes.
Okay, if it freezes, I'll just switch off my video then. That might make it a little smoother. Sorry, there seems to be.
Oh, Yamini, I can switch off my video as well. That might be eating up some bandwidth. In case there's issues.
Okay, so till it works, and then one of us can switch off our videos. All right, sorry, sorry, folks. Sorry about that. So let me, just picking up from where Zoom sort of left off, I think one of the big challenges with the way in which we've thought, the way in which our policymakers have imagined the dynamic of the Indian economy and the dynamic of growth in India has been very much in terms of these trade-offs between growth and welfare, and in that context, India's peculiar structural transformation, where growth actually took place against the backdrop of high-skilled services sector, rather than making most use of our comparative advantage, which was low-skilled, labor-intensive manufacturing sectors, has sort of put us in a place where we've been able to grow to a certain point, but grow obviously without necessarily ensuring that the rest of India participates in it. And this brings me to the second big political economy challenge that the Indian economy and our debates on welfare now confront. When you have growth, that is by design unequal, and we are seeing this now very much in the data. We know that the top 1% of India has a significantly higher share in national income since either the period of the economic reforms, while the bottom half share of in national income actually dropped in this period. So we know that the nature of our growth has resulted in deep inequality, even though overall, in absolute numbers, poverty certainly increased. In a democracy, deep inequality doesn't necessarily sustain itself from a political point of view. So that's one of the interesting reasons why the welfare state as a narrative within our politics, we used to, in the days before Donald Trump, refer to this as populism. These days, the word populism means many different kinds of things. So we have started referring to this much more in terms of freebies rather than populism. But it creates a certain kind of politics about of welfare that focuses very much on ensuring a certain degree of support or welfare provisioning to those who are at the bottom end of the welfare architecture. No matter how much the current national government, the BJP government, talks today, or at least used to in the 2014 through till about 2017 phase, about a more market-led economy, you will see that very quickly it switches to a much more quote unquote welfarist political narrative, one that talks about schemes for the poor rather than big large scale reforms of the economy to deepen India's project of open markets and liberalization over time. And therefore one sees that there's actually a very clear political consensus in India's political narrative of welfare. Now, this is a contested question because we know that some types of political parties or political formations have an ideology that's much more deeply about welfare, whereas others, like our current national government's political ideology, is still actually articulating itself in terms of whether it is necessarily about welfare or other things. But you see the idea of welfare as a narrative that cuts across all political formations of all ideological hues. How it articulates itself may be different. But there's one very clear common thread, and that common thread is what Ratin Roy, the economist, refers to often as the compensatory state. It is a state that's willing to invest a certain proportion of its prioritization and resources in providing basic welfare for the chronically poor. And actually, if you look at the structure of India's welfare state, you'll also see that really the bulk of our investments in welfare are mostly rural and mostly focused on the chronically poor. We saw the consequences of this post the lockdown when the migrant worker crisis rather highlighted the question of urban safety nets, as well as more importantly, the question of labor protection and labor rights and social safety nets for the informal workers. But the important thing here is that we see a politics of welfare on compensatory welfare, but it doesn't necessarily translate itself into a politics of welfare that is essentially about a politics of the provision of high quality public goods, of building human capability, the fundamental core of the argument. So we often scratch our heads and ask about the great puzzle of why is it that a democratic country like India, with such deep-seated inequality, still doesn't have health and education at the center of its narrative of welfare. And I think one part of the answer lies in this the nature of our growth trajectory, the very clear political consensus, at least until very recently, that growth in some ways needs to be achieved through investments in high-skilled, high-services kind of structural transformation, and that the answer to the failure of our growth to create a middle layer in which all could participate is to provide a certain degree of compensatory welfare, but one that doesn't fundamentally ask the fundamental core structural questions about the nature of our structural transformation and ask very fundamental questions about the dynamics of inequality. So that's my second proposition. The third proposition, and I'll stop at that point, is that this particular politics of compensatory welfare has come at the risk of undermining a very core element of what civil society was trying to achieve through its engagement with the question of building a welfare state, which was actually the centrality in the framework of social justice, rights, and duties. So if you look at the history of, you know, the real expansion of India's welfare state, which took place in the sort of 2004 to 2010 phase with the National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, with the right to education, with the, you know, and then a little belatedly, the National Food Security Act. I see that my internet is unstable again, so I'm going to turn off my video unless you can all hear me fine right now. Yash, I just got a message.
Your voice is audible, but your voice is sort of halting between again, yes.
I'm going to stop my video. I'm very sorry about the quality of the internet. So my third proposition is that the emphasis on the compensatory state not only undermines the ability to invest effectively in core public goods that are genuinely capability enhancing, not to argue that some of these compensatory welfare do not ensure at least a basic minimal layer of protection, but it doesn't provide the kind of capability enhancement that is needed for populations to become active participants in growth and active participants in the economy. The third proposition is that this very narrative of the compensatory state also comes in the way of building a genuinely robust rights-enabled welfare architecture, because it doesn't see welfare as a tool to effectively challenge structural inequalities within society. It sees welfare merely as a quote-unquote safety net, merely as a compensation. So even as India's big expansion in welfare that took place in that 2004 to 2010 period sought to reframe fundamentally the relationship between citizens and the state by articulating welfare in the language of rights and in the grammar of entitlements, which essentially effectively is about citizens reorganizing the nature of their political dynamic vis-a-vis the state, asking and demanding, placing claims for welfare, placing claims for accountability for welfare on the state. It viewed this very much as an expansion of the political narrative, viewed this very much as an expansion of the compensatory architecture of the state. And I think that is the reason why the grammar of rights has still not been effectively embedded within the architecture of the welfare state, despite now a decade plus of implementation of quote unquote rights-based schemes. So to close the argument I'm trying to make, it is that if equitable growth is very much about growth in which all participants, all citizens can be equal participants in the economy. To achieve that, the state needs to consider economic policy in a way that the structural transformation beyond high-skilled, high growth to a different pathway. Arriving at that different pathway requires a shift in our understanding, in our political economy of the welfare state, rather, a political economy of a welfare state that has been fueled by the emphasis on growth over welfare, or growth, growth with inequality, rather, which has created an architecture of welfare that in and of itself is essentially compensatory without effectively investing in core public goods, that undermines the project of welfare as rights, and therefore undermines the ability of citizens to articulate more robust claims of welfare on the state and on our politics to create a genuinely robust welfare state that fuels growth rather than serves as a compensation for growth that has not been able to reach all Indians. So we need to be able to think about welfare not as a for lack of a better word, not so much as a sideshow to growth or as something that is necessary to compensate a growth, but something that is intrinsically part of growth and something that effectively compensates growth. Essentially, you will not have growth without robust welfare, is my final argument and final proposition. Over to all of you for questions.
Thank you, Yamini. Thank you so much. That was incredibly insightful. I especially really appreciated and like the reconceptualization of welfare in the modern era and how that needs to change from a mere compensatory safety net to something that is more expansive and more participatory. Moving on from that, I think it's time for questions. I would like to pose the first question before we head on to the Q&A. And I see that we already have three questions with us as well. That's great. Please, everyone, keep your questions incoming. Yamini, my question to you then is, this past week, during the campaigning in Bihar, the party that's currently leading the national government mentioned that they would be providing free vaccinations to the citizens of that state. So my question to you then is, not only is welfare, or how you have defined it, compensatory safety nets being, I guess, excluded, but it's also being dangled in front of people and it's being made to believe that such compensatory schemes or mechanisms are really the end all and be all. And after that, the citizens should be happy and they would be their well-being would be taken care of. But as you said, that shouldn't be the case. So I just wanted your comments with relation as to what's been happening in Bihar of late.
Thanks. So I think I'm glad you brought this up, because this example, what is happening during the elections right now really highlights, I think, the core point that I'm making. Think about it this way. We have in the last 8 months experienced a global pandemic, one in which even an untenable, in my opinion, decision like the lockdown was legitimized because we have traditionally failed to invest in our public health system. We have traditionally failed to invest in our public systems, period. And health, almost more than education, has been a deep sufferer of that. Why is it that a country which has almost 90% of its workforce engaged in the informal sector, and a significant proportion of that engaged in casual daily wage work with absolutely no social protection, could find an elite that legitimized, in fact, asked government to go into a lockdown? The argument was made that we need to do this because our public health systems are so poor that if we don't, quote unquote, flatten the curve, it'll be even worse for the poor. We started there. We saw for a serious period of time the kind of suffering that imposed on all migrants. We have consistently seen after June, when migrant workers finally found some dignity and ways of making of reaching home. And an economy that has not been able to V-shape itself back, continues not to be able to V-shape or K-shape or frankly any shape, way shape its way back. And we also remain in the midst of a global of a pandemic that doesn't look like it's receding anytime soon. And yet we are having an election that is not talking about the importance of building and investing the public health system in Bihar. It is talking about one very thin end of that wedge, which is a vaccination immunization program, and saying we will give that to you for free. So, you know, this is the complex political economy of welfare in India. I'm not arguing at some level against freebies per se. I don't believe they are freebies. I think the term freebie is problematic in and of itself. But I am arguing against a welfare politics that inevitably seeks to privilege the handing out of certain kinds of provisioning over the core investment in that public health system. India has a robust public health system. We don't even need to worry too much about rushing into a vaccination, because India's fatality rates are luckily not as significant, not as severe as were anticipated at the start of the lockdown. What really will save India is a public health system that ensures that a potential carrier of COVID is able to access a hospital system early in the progression of the disease, access good therapeutic care, and especially a patient with comorbidities is able to find themselves good care very early on in the disease. That is what we need. Yet we are talking entirely about free vaccinations that are not going to, we are talking about eradication rather than managing a disease at a time when we are in the height of managing that disease. I'll tell you from personal experience, I am, as Yash knows, dealing with COVID in my own household, and our family cook, my parents' family cook also tested positive. And we searched to see, he didn't have a place for to be in home quarantine. So we searched to see if there were government facilities. People I spoke to, including in government itself, said, if you can avoid a government facility, please do. That's the state of our public health system. Yet we are only talking about vaccines. That's our big welfare. That's the big question of the politics of welfare that we need to break.
Yes, completely agreed. The very fact that something as mandatory and something as what should be basically provided, a public health, is in fact being politicized during such a troublesome time is itself eye-opening to everyone. Thank you, Yamini, for that. I will be moving on to the Q&A section in the bar right now. The first question, and the one that has been upvoted the maximum, is by Devika Dinesh. She asks whether it is politically feasible to make policies that move away from this culture of welfare state dependency. And the second part of a question is, would it be possible anytime in the near future to cut down on the plethora of redundant welfare schemes that exist at all levels without facing high political backlash for the same?
Thanks. So that's a fairly core question. My core proposition is that welfare and investments in welfare and growth are inextricably linked. And I think that that's really the core starting point. So I don't think of welfare as dependency. I think of welfare very much within the framework of rights, duties, and obligations. So it is central to the dynamic of citizen-state relations. I think of welfare very central to our definition of what citizenship in it, or the articulation of citizenship in and of itself is, by which I mean at the heart of what the practice of citizenship means is the relationship with the state where you're treated where the relationship with the state is determined on the basis of equity and justice, and not on the basis of kinship, position, caste, status, ethnic, or any other identity. And a strong, robust welfare state is essentially about a state that enables the enables the well-being of all citizens. And by that, I mean the ability to ensure that all citizens are able to realize their capabilities, regardless of kinship, caste, ethnic identity, and so on and so forth. Now, moving from that proposition, what does welfare effectively mean, and where and how should we be able, how should we be resourcing the welfare state? That is at its core a question of policy making and priority setting. And I think that the big, and like I said, the big question in the big conundrum that we face in the politics of welfare in India is this emphasis on the compensatory welfare rather than the emphasis on investments in core public systems. And that brings me to the question, to the issue that you pose about fiscal capacity and whether there are schemes that redundant forms of welfare that schemes that need to be done away with. And I think this brings us to one of the core challenges to the welfare state in India today, which is about the capacity and the capability of the state itself. I think that one of the big challenges that the Indian state faces is that it has over the decades learned how to deliver schemes, but it still doesn't have the capability to think about coming to the aggregation of schemes into strengthening a particular sector or a particular public system. So think about agriculture. You're able to devise a whole host of schemes that are linked to specific subsidies. But the state hasn't been able to build its capability to actually effectively look at agriculture in a holistic way from production to marketing, and then articulate what are the kinds of core inputs that need to be provided through a set of schemes to achieve the output or the outcome that it seeks. And part of the reason for this is that the Indian state in its bureaucracy and administrative structure, fueled no doubt by its politics, functions on the basis of silos. It has a policy-making process that has over time and now completely done away with a structural process of planning and fiscal medium term to long term fiscal plans, and intertwined into that is a politics that is used to and getting increasingly more vocal in announcing schemes that are now identified very much with particular political personalities that then make it very difficult to actually genuinely design policy interventions that are holistic, that are intersecting, that bring together the complexity of what we need to address. And so you get these multiple schemes that create an administrative burden and unfairly impact implementation. So just by example, if you just even today go to the DBT website, you're going to find that there are almost 500 direct benefit transfer subsidy schemes that are run by the government of India. You add into that state schemes, average state schemes are between 250 to 300. India doesn't have a dearth of schemes meant to support the poor. Each of these schemes only attacks a very, very tiny part of this larger problem. None of these are intertwined and intermeshed into a larger vision of economic and welfare policy. And added to that is a politics that defines itself on schemes and announcements, and an administration then that has to be responsive to those schemes and announcements, which leads you into this complex world of the plethora of schemes and silo-driven implementation that gives you lots of inputs, but doesn't give you the kind of capability enhancing quality and effective public system that we need. So a simple example, we have a plethora of schemes on for education. We have a very vast set of inputs for education that are financed through these schemes, yet 50% of children in standard 5 can barely read a standard 2 textbook.
Yes, yes. I think the wastage of schemes, especially of so-called welfare schemes, is visible for everyone to see, and the compensatory benefits of them just keep on adding on top of each other without exacting any real structural change. So thank you again for that, Yamini. Moving on to the next question. This one is posted by one of our own Rethinking Economics members, Ankush Garg. He asks, how different is the idea or the design of a welfare state if we are to have one in India from that of the Eurocentric vision of it? And can you also talk about the role of universal basic income in that context and whether it fits into the entire compensatory safety net welfare narrative that you have talked about today, Yamini?
Sure. I think, one of the big questions that many economists have posed, especially when looking at the European welfare state architecture, is one of sequence. And then the second question is of universalization. So the issue of sequence has always been the issue of what comes first, core public goods or universal safety nets. And I think that the peculiar histories in which the evolution of the welfare state took place in Europe actually make this a moot question in India. In a democratic setting, the powers of democracy, which is really the one thing in my opinion, and this is where I think first principles matter a lot. The power of democracy is really what has saved India. And that's one of the reasons why actually the welfare state narrative itself has become so complex, because democracy has provided a very crucial political voice to India's disempowered and marginalized citizens. You saw this particularly in the 1990s onwards, in the Mandal 1990s to mid 2000s, I would say, politics, where Mandalization of politics, particularly in North India, but you saw this, of course, in Southern India much earlier on, created a wave of political movements in which the space of politics became central to, with democracy basically provided the space for the articulation of voice of the historically disempowered communities. But that articulation came in a funny way. It came at one level in the form of access to state power, rather than access to state power to express social power, rather than access to state power to be able to provide for the socioeconomic rights of all citizens. Which is why, particularly in North India, Bihar and Uttar Pradesh being two very critical examples of a politics of social justice or rather a politics of empowerment of voice that didn't necessarily translate itself into a politics of social and economic rights of the very citizens for whom access to state power was such an important, access to state power was so important to be able to, for social mobility and for the exercise of social power, yet the demand was for power, the demand was not for socioeconomic rights. I think particularly in the early 2000s, the narrative of democracy also shifted a little bit. And democracy made it very difficult for political actors to be able to talk about state power without talking about the schemes and the freebies. I think what it did do is create a foundation of the sort of targeted social
welfare policy structure, which is different to what we saw in Europe, which was able to provide a much broader base of social insurance and employment-linked labor movement sort of created that space for employment-linked social protection. That is not the case in India. But but demands of democracy resulted in creating this very targeted, oriented social welfare provisioning, and it has always remained a big Achilles heel, a big question mark and a big Achilles heel. Can you, for a country as large and poor as India, actually create a universalized social protection question, a social protection architecture? Now, there is some evidence to suggest, particularly if you look at the public distribution system, that in fact, when you universalize, you end up with a far better targeted social welfare architecture, which is able to reach all of the poor, because you avoid the traditional inclusion-exclusion errors and the traditional politics of targeting that is very, very visible in the everyday lives of citizen-state engagement in India. We've had a similar question in the debates on universal basic income as well, where India is not really debating a universal basic income. India is debating a quasi-universal basic income to the extent that we'll have anything. And to me, again, that undermines the whole point of a robust welfare. If you look at NREGA, what NREGA did was create a very unique universal guarantee of employment that in its architecture was based on a self-targeting mechanism that ensured to a very high degree that it was those who needed it that were best able to reach it, to access it. So to my mind, the debate on universal basic income in India is actually not really a debate on universality at all. It is a debate on a base on the provision of a targeted income support floor. And to my mind, we need to be able to critique and question the targeting in and of itself. I think universal self-targeted schemes in a resource-constrained environment are a much more effective way of ensuring that benefits reach those who need it, that the welfare state reaches those who need it the most. I think articulating this in the language of rights is very crucial to deepening the project of democracy and to shifting and to entering into a sort of second phase of democratic deepening in India. The first phase of democratic deepening was the ability of historically discriminated citizens to be able to use democratic processes to access state power. The second phase of that has to be the articulation, conversion of access to state power rather, into the provision of rights and deepening of citizenship for all, which is why universality is important. The income support in and of itself as a tool for welfare, again, I think brings us into the question of compensation versus a genuinely capability enhancing state. And for me, welfare is about genuine capability enhancement, not compensation.
Okay, yes, thank you. Thank you again for that, Yamini. You, coming back to what you earlier said about the aspect of participation in the designing of welfare schemes, my question, and a few other folks have also put this up, would be, how would you define participation then? Are we to say that the grassroots level panchayati bodies would be what you're talking about, or are we to define participation through another lens or through another mode?
So that's a really excellent question. That I think of participation in two ways, and they are both deeply intertwined. I think of participation as a genuine participation in the democratic process, which is effectively a process that enables the articulation of the needs and priorities of all citizens and pushes the political process to be responsive to that. A genuinely responsive political process does not will never be able to successfully embark on a project of growth that deepens inequality. A genuinely political participatory political process will, by virtue of the pulls and pressures of democracy, have to identify a pathway of growth that enables all citizens to be able to be active and effective participants in it. So, and that's where I find the political debate on unemployment and jobs really, really interesting and very, very important and critical. Any political debate that talks about unemployment as central, and you know, again, let's go back to Bihar. Tejasvi Yadav is bringing this up in a very, very big way, right? As part of in Bihar, as almost as a counter to the sort of politics of free vaccinations that the BJP is bringing to the table. And I think that the challenge that India has, India's political processes have faced, is that even as it is able to recognize the importance of the unemployment or jobs as a central political tool of political mobilization that needs to be responded to, its economic policy has never been able to effectively find a way out of that. Now, part of the reason that we've never been, you know, the economist will tell you, oh yeah, that's because we didn't do factor market reform. Yes, we didn't in as deep a way as the market economy, free marketer would like us to. So rid yourself of land laws, labor laws, allow the market to do what the market needs to do. But in a democracy, these are much more complex issues. They have to deal with questions of social justice. They have to deal with questions of equity. They have to deal with questions of rights. But in India, it gets even more complicated because the nature of our political, because of the nature of growth and the nature of inequality, which has essentially created a plutocracy. So private capital in India captures our politics in a way, and our politics now is driven so much by hard money that our politics also is caught in its own web. It needs to respond to the challenge of unemployment because that is core to the everyday needs and priorities of its voter base at a very raw and fundamental level. And that challenge of unemployment is getting even more sharp, not just because the economy today is slowing down or we've had a history of jobless growth. We've also had the rising of aspirations of in the context of a demographic dividend and a really god-awful public education system. So you've got this funny mismatch of job seekers and vacancies in high service industries because they're not finding the right kind of skills to be able to meet their human resource requirements. But it's in this context that our politics is also not being able to respond in ways that are genuinely able to consider what are ways in which we can infuse and inject momentum in the economy, in certain kinds of sectors, in certain kinds of manufacturing that would genuinely enable and empower most of India to be active participants in the economy. And I think that's a very critical part of this entire puzzle. I mean, just think right now of all of our key drivers of economic growth and just map out for yourself big infrastructure, software, increasingly tech infrastructure, which are the few big industry that have occupied that, and how much employment generation is going to come from those economies, and how can you genuinely design policy, because often there will be clashes between industry interests and people's labor interests and people's interests if your economy is essentially governed and your politics is essentially governed by a handful of private capital.
Thank you for that, Yamini, again. That was very, very insightful. And that actually provides another pathway to the next two questions that I would like to ask. And these are also crowdsourced. The first one is based on the future of work. And the question is, how would the current digitalization and the technology revolution affect welfare and inequality? And the second question comes back to, Yamini, what you were mentioning about the private capital and how welfare seems to be concentrated and increasingly corporatized. I said it finally. And the question revolves around whether you think that a participatory welfare state can be driven by corporate philanthropy or initiatives by private capital to give back to society through social responsibility.
Thanks for these very, very important questions. Let me address the digitization question from two perspectives. One is more technical about the nature and the architecture of the welfare state, and then the second is sort of more the future of work sort of question. Let's tackle the digitization issue first. I think increasingly in India, starting with Aadhaar back in 2009-10, but really accelerating with DBT, JAM, and these sort of new acronyms that have entered our welfare vocabulary, we have seen an increasing quote-unquote digitization of the delivery of welfare. Now, it's important to understand where this frenzy for digitization is coming from, and engage with it a little bit to ask whether this is essentially going to what kind of welfare state this is going to create for us. At one very basic level, the legitimization for digitization is coming from a very fundamental reality that we cannot escape from, and certainly I, as somebody who pushes the idea of the welfare state, cannot escape from, which is the reality of the indisciplined, unruly, extremely corrupt, patronage-dispensing local state that cuts across India. I mean, I remember way back in the early 2000s when NREGA was being debated, it was often argued, instead, this is fiscal profligacy at its worst, because all it's going to do is, not only get us into deep fiscal deficit, but get us into deep fiscal deficit while fattening the pockets of the local BDO and the local Lala, because it'll be the contractor Raj, not the people's Raj. This is because of the inefficiencies and corruptions that are so deeply embedded within our welfare state. What is so attractive about digitization is that it opens up the possibility of getting rid of this corrupt contractor, unruly, indisciplined local officer who doesn't show up to work, who shows up to work, demands chai pani ka paisa, usually of the poorest person. And it in fact allows the state to deliver its largesse or its welfare in whichever way and form it does directly into the hands of the people in different ways and forms. Now, this is very, very attractive in theory, but it brings with it two crucial problems. One must remember that this preoccupation with wanting to get rid of the state presents itself with another conundrum. A digital state actually requires a very, very deeply sophisticated state. Let me illustrate this with the following example. I mentioned earlier the challenge of the targeted nature of India's welfare architecture. All the welfare schemes that India delivers today are targeted. Sometimes they are targeted at obviously visible populations like women or old age pensions or old age, but mostly they are targeted at somewhat harder to identify population that is quote unquote below poverty line, right? Now we have the SECC, so people who on a multidimensional index of poverty are at a certain level and therefore require access to government welfare services. Now, what the digital system can do in the context of the SECC, the digital system can create a database, and on that database, it will say that Yamini is Yamini, and Yamini today has a kacha house, one scooter, no refrigerator, one light bulb, okay? And when the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana is announced, I may potentially, on the basis of those attributes, qualify for the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. Now, having the database really helps because the local officer can't deny me this because it's in the database. The problem is that I didn't have a refrigerator when the data was collected, but 2 years later, I do have a refrigerator. The system knows this, so it chooses to update its list. In the process of updating the list, there can be a huge row between me and Yash, because Yash also wants access to the scheme and will keep insisting that he deserves to be in the database as well. No amount of technology is going to be able to solve this problem. The technology can at best say, Yamini has these attributes. I am now updating them to the 21st of or 25th of October 2020 to be XYZ. But the technology is not going to be able to determine whether Yash should come into this or not. Yash will dispute, why is it that uske paas refrigerator hai to usko ghar mil nahi mil or uske paas refrigerator nahi hai to usko ghar nahi mil raha hai, but mere paas hai, but meri aamdani kam hai. That is a political process. It is a political process that requires political negotiation, for which the political process needs to be empowered and capable of negotiating. That is problem number one. Problem number two, I saw this in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan when we were studying the updation of SECC. There is one Gram Panchayat secretary who has been asked to do this updation. One Gram Panchayat secretary, on average in most parts of India, is in charge of at least four Gram Panchayats. Every single officer we went to said, we don't have the people, we don't have the staff, we just do not have the ability to be able to do this. When we started converting to DBT, the financial process became even more complicated. Bank accounts had to be opened. Most citizens are still not fully financially literate. There is a gap distance between where they live and where the bank is. There are problems with the banking system. Even all of us who are well-versed with internet banking on our mobile phones often find ourselves having made a mistake here, password lock ho gaya, kisi ko phone karna hai. How do you get there? The banking system doesn't always respond to you. It needs intermediaries. And none of these intermediaries exist because, ironically, in India, even though that local state is the cause of all our problems, the local state is also extremely understaffed. India's frontline state, public employment in India's frontline state, actually public employment in India, in the Indian state, as a percentage of GDP is far, as per capita, is far lower compared to any other OECD. The Indian state is very, very small. It simply doesn't have the people. And for digitization, you can't avoid people. Actually, funnily enough, you need a lot more people for a whole set of new skills that are about bringing the digital to the person. The last bigger question, in the context of digitization becomes a tool to be able to centralize authority. Let me go back to the dispute between Yamini, Yash and the Panchayat secretary about whether or not Yash should enter into the system. The Panchayat secretary is not empowered to make that decision, because in a digital world, to prevent any kind of mistakes being made or corruption taking place at the local level, it is in fact the state government that is making out the list and handing it over and saying, isko update karo, isse aage piche aur kuch nahi kar sakte. So the local officer actually is not empowered to make discretionary decisions at the grassroots, therefore is not empowered to be responsive to what is being asked for. It is in fact becoming a far more centralized state. So what then happens to the powers of the local political process to negotiate these? We've been tracking for many, many years panchayat finances. I found that once digitization took place, many, many schemes, monies for which would reach the panchayat bank accounts, actually disappeared from the panchayat bank account, because no longer was this ever going to touch the panchayat. It went straight into an individual's bank account, dropped directly from somewhere else. Now, what it did in the process is that it disempowered the panchayat from being able to negotiate. Admittedly, the panchayat is an extremely corrupt entity, but core first principles of public finance, principle of subsidiary, that which should be implemented at that which should be done at that level of administration must be done at that level of administration, because that is where local systems of accountability can cohere and actually get realized. So the challenge of the rights of exercising rights in a digital state is that citizens may continuously go to the state saying, I haven't received my entitlement. But the state will turn around and say, I'm not empowered to answer that question. Go to the chief minister, go to the prime minister. That brings us to a very crucial trade-off. Now I'm going to talk in the economist language. There is a trade-off between efficiency, accountability, and democracy. And we do have to weigh those trade-offs very, very carefully, particularly in the context of the welfare state, as we make these big transitions. So that was on digitization at one level. That's my response to the question on digitization. On the question of the future of work, look, I mean, I think that this is definitely a challenge that India needs to prepare for going forward if you take a sort of, you know, 30-year horizon. But India is going to face this challenge in a very peculiar way because we still haven't been able to figure out how to ensure basic foundational literacy to most Indian citizens who are going to Indian schools, government or private for that matter. It is a fact that for the last 15 years, Asar has been reminding us that 50% of kids finish 5 years of schooling and still can barely read a standard two text. So to me, the big challenge for India in order to be able to prepare for the future of work is to at least ensure that this basic foundational literacy and numeracy is provided for on a mission mode. I think the new education policy is a good step in that direction in the sense that it clearly articulates this. Whether the Indian state is going to be able to be responsive to this or not and actually invest in its public systems is an open question. On the question of the role of private capital, and the role of corporates and corporate philanthropy in the welfare state. Look, you know, I do not see anything that can substitute for the state in the provision of welfare except for the state. It is ultimately in a democracy, my normative underpinning is that it is the responsibility of the state to be able to invest in its systems to provide for these core public goods. I see the role of philanthropy very much in the realm of innovation and in the realm of experimentation and provisioning that supports the state. But I worry very much about a state that is increasingly the state in India, that is disenchanted with its own ability to provide, to build its public systems to provide. I have spent years talking in conversations with government bureaucrats in health, education, rural development, panchayati raj, who will express a deep disenchantment in the state's ability to do anything and are seeking this enigma of the public-private partnership to be able to deliver on things where the state failed. We've seen an infrastructure that badly thought through public-private partnerships actually lead you to more problems than less and build a form of cronyism that's extremely hard to exit from. That's the current slowdown challenge that India was facing before the pandemic. And I think that another aspect of this disenchantment with the state's ability to do anything is that you're increasingly seeing private sector becoming the state. State government after state government after state government has got armies of Boston Consulting Group, McKinsey, PricewaterhouseCoopers, KPMGs, you name it, doing the job of the state. And that is a problem. That is a problem because the private sector will never in a democratic context function like the state. Its accountabilities are different, its incentives are different, its motives are different. So I'm not a statist ideologue in any way, but I do think we need to critique the increasing privatization of the state from the perspective of what this means for the future of our public systems.
Yes, yes, and I think the ongoing pandemic has inadvertently proved the right pathway for that because of the ongoing and the increasing participation of civil society organizations. Yamini, unfortunately, we'll have to draw the session to a close. We promised everyone only an hour's worth of your time. Thank you so much for answering the questions and for delivering your address. My personal takeaways from everything that you said were that we have to broaden our understanding of welfare to something that enhances our capability rather than just compensates for something that we are lacking. And secondly, how you talked about accountability, democracy versus the trade-off of efficiency, especially when it comes to the binaries of economic growth, something that we have seen throughout the post-liberalization era of India. Thank you again, Yamini, for joining us this Saturday afternoon. It was a pleasure to have you.
My pleasure. And,
finally, before we close, some shameless self-serving. Do follow the Rethinking Economics India Network and the Project Statecraft on social media. The links for all of our respective accounts are contained in the chat. Reminder also for the policy workshop to all those who have signed up. The workshop will begin at 5 sharp. And reminder also for tomorrow's keynote address as well as the Socratic dialogue. Finally, if you do wish to be a part of either of our organizations, do reach out and we'll definitely get back to you. Till then, stay safe, everyone. And thank you again for joining us this Saturday afternoon. Bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you, Yamini.